My name's Steve Feltham, full-time hunter of the Loch Ness Monster, and you're listening to the Unbelievers Podcast.
Japan, a country known for everything from onsen hot springs and kabuki baths to all-night neon-lit dance parties, anime, and sushi boat restaurants. But did you know that Japan is also known for its myriad of strange and unusual cryptid creatures? Tonight, the Unbelievers Podcast looks to the land of the rising sun as we explore some of the many interesting and anomalous monsters that reside in Nippon. And we're not talking Pokemon, because these possibly real entities are even weirder. Can umbrellas be trusted? Are ancient aliens reliant on bowls? And who's that guy in the tracksuit? Well, find out now as we take a deep bow to the cryptids of Japan. Right here on the program, we continue to learn to unlearn everything you know. Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm Russ Ryan, and joining me as always is Drea Mora. Hello, Drea.
Yo, what's up?
And soundboard engineer and producer Rob Oki.
What's up, guys? What's happening?
Wow, classic. Familiar voice. Haven't heard the cactus in a while. That's a apropos for tonight. Yeah, man. I'm excited. Yeah. I'm excited. We're not only talking about cryptids, but yeah, we get to talk about things from a distant land.
Yes. Yeah.
Excellent.
way to
distant
tie that together.
Earth,
I like
better.
That. Yeah.
I thought that's what you did. You played. That's a singing Japanese cactus. Of course, the classic
it is,
clip.
It is.
I miss that little cactus so much. One of the greatest.
I wonder if that cactus is still alive.
They live for a long time.
They really do.
Like, I think some cactuses can live for hundreds of
years.
I might be making that up.
No, I think you're right. Like, saguaro cactuses, they take, like, forever. They take, like, fucking decades to grow an arm and shit.
Whoa.
So,
that's crazy. Decades just to grow an arm?
Think about those redwood trees, huh?
But if that cactus is still around, can you imagine the stuff it's singing now? I mean, it's got to be way just past. No, I'll play the clip again. What did it say back then? It was just like... Yeah, it's probably got a podcast at this point. Look up Japanese Cactus Podcast. It's probably out there. But that's for another time, because tonight we will be talking about cryptids of Japan. The great Sushi Mamiri with Show You My Soy Sauce. What does that song even mean? It must have something to do with the topic.
Show you.
Must have something to do with the topic for tonight, because we are talking cryptids, and it feels like it has been a while since we delved into the fantastic world of undiscovered creatures.
It has been. I'm sure there's a bunch of new ones out there that we haven't talked about. And because, you know, there's always new ones popping up, cryptids. They never stop.
They never stop.
But we get so bogged down with the mountain monsters and the Alaska monsters and all this U.S. stuff. And these are not your typical cryptids that we are accustomed to, like Sasquatch or Dogman, or Lizardman or Frogman or Mothman. The subjects for tonight.
Any of the numerous men.
Any of the numerous men. There's no mans tonight. Because the subjects from tonight all originate from the faraway land of Japan. So you know they will be super weird and kind of fucked up, yes?
Most likely.
I guess, yeah, that does kind of describe some of the entertainment that's out there in Japan. They are into some weird stuff. Like, you know, anime, that kind of stuff. I've never really watched a lot of it, but I know there's some strange elements going on there.
Yeah, it's like, I know we've got a lot of strange and weird shit, and I would say no offense, Japan, except I know they don't take offense because they love it. They lean into the weird.
The weirdness, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's why everyone loves Japan. I know I do. And we're going to start off with a fairly new cryptid on the scene, and this is a creature known as the Ningen, which translates to what, Drea? Like, literally.
I think it's Ningen, but it's human.
Yeah, it just translates to human being. Ningen translates pretty much directly to being human being. And this creature was first reported in the early 2000s on a Japanese message board called 2Channel, or 2chan, For those in the know. And where stories, where there were stories of Arctic humanoid life forms inhabiting the icy waters of the Antarctic. And this was gaining a lot of buzz on the internet. And reportedly, they were observed on multiple occasions by crew members of government-operated whale research ships. This is kind of the origin story here. 2chan board. They're talking about something weird going on whale research ships.
I, for some reason, really trust whale researchers. I don't know why, but right now I trust these people. I feel like these are good. This is a good resource.
Yeah, because they sound like scientists, right? If they're researching whales. Yeah. They got to know stuff.
Yeah, they know some stuff about some big animals. So yeah, I kind of trust them right now.
All right, well, let's see if that trust remains, because we are going to hear the description of this Ningen from a great documentary on the creature from YouTuber Swamp Dweller. And Swamp Dweller, he's going to help us imagine this all-new aquatic anomaly.
According to eyewitness accounts, Ningen are equipped with two long, flat appendages at its sides. A pair of monstrous pectoral fins which bear an eerie resemblance to human arms. The caudal fin at the rear of the creature appears to actually be two separate structures, which are positioned on either side of a short tail. The Ningen's head is a rudimentary circular structure that merges directly with its trunk. Like a fish or a ray, there is no distinct neck or shoulder separating the head from the body. Its facial features are said to be very simplistic, consisting of only two large black eyes and a small slit for a mouth.
So this thing is like a giant walking pants in some of the descriptions you'll see. But it's got, you know, sometimes it's got arms and even fingers, but it is really big. It's really big, and I'll say it looks like something a kid could easily draw.
I know, I did see pictures of it. It looks cute, except for the idea that it's like massive, right?
It's designed to be hugged, strangely enough. It's like, it's got no arms. And some of the, that's the weird thing about it. Sometimes it has arms, sometimes it doesn't have arms.
Sometimes it's a hugger, sometimes it needs to be hugged.
Yeah, sometimes, exactly. That's kind of what I was thinking. It's weird looking, though. It looks like, I don't even know, like a dolphin's head with just the head with legs.
Yeah, there's no neck at all. It becomes one unit, and the head, of course, looks almost alien-looking, but like the walking pants if they had some kind of expression. It looks like something, if someone like a very Etsy-minded crypto person wanted to think of something that they could easily knit or draw or anything, it's like almost like that.
I mean,
yeah, sculpically.
Let's take this moment right now just for the listeners. You know, do yourself a favor and just grab your phone, pull it out, pull up the old Google device, and just type in N-I-N-G-E-N, and just look at the photos that pop up there. Give him a quick glance.
Oh, he's great. If you see this, yeah, you probably saw it in the when we posted about the episode. We definitely all have the Ningen included. With a lot of these, that's the thing with cryptids. You definitely have to have a look at them.
Did you hear how they described him, though, Russ? Real quick, did you hear how they described him? It sounded like they were describing a gray alien, kind of. They were like, slit for a mouth. When the fuck do you ever hear that? Besides when people are describing a gray alien.
Or a fish, that's I guess. Or a giant, whatever.
Slit for a mouth. I've never described a fish's mouth. First off, I don't think I've ever described a fish's mouth to anyone just in general. Like, that's
hey, you know
thing.
Like a fish's mouth? You know how they go, like a slit?
But second off, I don't think I would ever describe it as a slit. It's more of a hole, to be honest, but that's a whole different...
That's
a
different episode, and we'll get into it. We talked enough about fishing and Rob's fishing sneakers.
Different podcast altogether.
Let's get back to Ningen here, because according to the original 2chan post, the crew of that government vessel in the Antarctic spotted what they thought was a foreign submarine, and as they drew nearer to the object, they realized this is not a submarine.
That's no submarine.
But a giant aquatic humanoid-looking creature that was swimming just below the surface. And as they closed in, whatever this was, is Ningen, it submerged and disappeared, and it left that crew shook.
I got a bad feeling about this.
The crew was shook. They saw what they thought was ice just kind of disappear. This is a real internet mystery. This is a giant sea-dwelling humanoid hidden in the South Seas.
It's creepy, though. Yeah. I don't like the idea of something that huge. Like, the pictures I saw of it, like I said, I thought looked pretty cute, but I think if I were to see that, like, in person, in the water, I'd probably piss my pants.
Yeah, no, you would not think this thing's cute.
It wouldn't be cute. Don't want to hug it.
The artist's rendition of it, you know, this artist took some liberties. Also, calling it What did you call it? It's that you said it's like it's human like it's or whatever. However they described it.
Yeah, it's a giant sea dwelling humanoid.
Humanoid.
It doesn't look human at all.
Doesn't look like a human. That you're being very kind.
There's a difference. We'll hear a little bit later. There are some actual what they think or even some Google images of this thing. But let's hear more of the story of the Ningen.
The lore of the Ningen quickly expanded to include a government implemented cover up. In this scenario, the powers that be are actively attempting to suppress any information regarding the existence of the Ningen. Owing to the possibility that Ningen may contain or secrete a chemical compound that is either medicinal or highly toxic in nature. Some people have gone as far as to make a loose connection between the Ningen and the legend of mermaids, although this is something of a stretch, considering the size and location disparities between the two mythological creatures.
Mm. Yeah, it's a big stretch, like literally to say that these things are close to mermaids. But you hear that part where he talks about, is this thing either secreting something medicinal or highly toxic?
Or toxic.
So what? Yeah. Is that what it is, that they're farming these things for their nefarious purposes?
Who?
I don't know these whaling guys, whoever is out there seeing these things.
No one's captured one, right?
It's like a undercover operation happening out there where these creatures exist and they're being farmed and there's a whole black market for Ningen.
Yes, and the story is breaking on 2chan in the mid-aughts is when this all went down. And along with these stories, there's also a number of alleged Ningen photographs. Like I mentioned, there is a Google image of one, and that had to be kind of hard to find, to go through Google Earth images of just
water. What do you mean there's a water?
There's a Google Earth image of what some people think is a Ningen, but most of them are dismissed as either whales or floating ice. They think that these images are floating ice that is somehow formed into what looks like a big just white thing just swimming around. But it is huge, but it could be ice or a whale.
Yeah, yeah. I hate to not mention the similarity that it has also to just the walking pants of Fresno, the Fresno Nightcrawler. In a lot of ways, it looks like maybe somehow connected. Maybe they're cousins. Maybe I don't know.
If they took off from Fresno and jumped into the ocean and evolved in front of our eyes,
yeah.
No, maybe they came from the ocean. You know how whales, right? Used to be walking on land allegedly or something. Whales used to have legs, is what people say.
Sick.
It's disgusting. It's awful. It should never happen again. And that's what this is, maybe. The walking pants have shed their walking legs and turned to swimming legs.
Well, I will say this. You are onto something with evolution because—
Sea legs.
Sea legs.
we're going to find out now. Is it possible for a creature like this to evolve and stay hidden until recently? Maybe.
Let's go back to the late Miocene. Just a quick jump of 6 million years. And we'll have a look at a collection of interesting characters known as the genus Thalassuchnus. This was a group of aquatic ground sloths who were unique to the late Miocene and subsequent Pliocene epoch. Over the space of 4 or 5 million years, drought conditions forced Thalassuchnus to evolve from being a near-shore land dweller to a marine hybrid that spent most of its time in the ocean. Our former ground sloth gradually became larger in its new habitat, with some of the bigger specimens growing to lengths of 10 or 11 feet. Thalassuchnus is a good example of a terrestrial life form that packed its bags and moved back to the oceans from whence it came, evolving new physical adaptations to adjust to life in the old neighborhood.
Okay, so ground sloths maybe are the cause of, the night pants and the Ningen. And yeah, they're called Thalassuch on this. That is the scientific name.
not what they said, Russ. They didn't say that. It was different. I don't know. I don't remember. Something similar, but I don't think it was that.
I'm just reading the script here.
I don't know how to pronounce things. It's fine.
Thalassuch on this? I don't think that's what they called them.
That's the ground sloths that have evolved into. Yeah, the ground sloths that evolved into aquatic creatures. In this, they think
water
this,
sloth.
Water sloths could have been a part of that. I like that they packed their bags and had a neighborhood. Yeah. That sounded nice.
I was like, what belongings did they bring with them? I'm very curious.
Yeah, well, I mean,
furniture?
Not a lot. They can't carry much with no arms.
Just underwear. So,
just have to. Hopefully, they have some sort of a backpack. They can just strap around their legs. I don't know.
I don't know.
It must be tough.
Pokemon cards and that's it.
Yeah. They kind of do have a Pokemon-ish look to them. It could be some sort of a rare Pokemon.
I have found that a lot of these, while I was doing research, I even came across there was a category underneath the cryptids that said Pokemon. And I was like, wait. I was like looking through it. I'm like, oh, so there's a lot of Pokemon that are based on a lot of these, you know, Japanese.
I mean, the pocket monsters.
Yeah, yeah.
There you go. That is kind of it. Sense. I mean, if you think about it, yes, people have tried to even copy it with, you know, what we consider classic cryptids, which is no, who's going to say that Pokemons are, you know, we already know about the Talpa guys. They love their Pokemon and stuff. So who knows if they're making them in actual cryptids. But as this guy goes on, he starts talking about Pangaea and new creatures like the Plesiosaur, and that some had long necks and some might have short ones, and maybe, you know, like this guy. So he could be some kind of ancient holdout, like the Nessie or the Ropin. They're thinking they're kind of trying to find some kind of family to put this guy in. And it's also noted that this area near Antarctica is home to blue whales, which have been hunted to near extinction because, you know, blue whales, they need to come to the surface for air, which makes them very vulnerable to spears and whatever else. But maybe the Ninjin evolved differently. They have the ability to stay deep underwater for long periods of time, not like the blue whales. But that is not all the Ninjin is supposedly capable of, because many depictions of this creature, like we said, they show it on land as if it could walk around, even though it's supposed to be this aquatic cryptid. So we've seen it walking around like the Fresno Nightcrawlers. And how is that even possible? Well, we might find out.
The longer fins at the creature's sides are said to strongly resemble human arms, with each one ending in a suggestion of multiple digits. This strange feature has provoked speculation what the Ninjin may actually walk around on dry land using the arm-like appendages at its sides as forelegs. But owing to the enormous weight of such a large animal, this feat of terrestrial locomotion would be nearly impossible. A creature of that size would struggle to support its own bulk outside of the buoyancy of the ocean habitat.
He's like, okay, maybe, but definitely not. This thing is way too big. It's probably standing on his fins with that blank express on his face. No, it's not. It can't really hold itself up.
It's sounding more and more like people are seeing like polar bears just from really far away. And that they're just kind of describing that, and that they're like, it does look a little weird sometimes. I could see that. You know, I was Googling the Ninjin as I was listening.
So wait,
to this.
Do you think the polar bear
suggestion of multiple digits?
Okay, I don't know how to work that in. I like he had a couple of flubs. It was funny listening, but I like the
suggestion of multiple digits.
Multiple digits.
Multiple. Well, yeah, that would be weird if they had multiple digits, because that's like monkeys, you know, and like obviously sloths, like they said. I was just Googling the Ninjin though here, just, you know, doing a little side research as we're actually recording the episode. And I see that there's a book on the Ninjin written by an author named Paul Rudd.
No way.
Yeah, definitely. Paul Rudd was definitely, he's definitely.
Paul Rudd.
He's definitely into the forefront of the Ninjin.
Paul Rudd.
It's the Paul Rudd, I believe, actually.
That's amazing.
Ant-Man himself has written a book about the Ninjin.
See, everyone's in the Ninjin. Ninjin rules.
Yeah, I didn't realize it was so mainstream.
All right, so I already picked on this guy for saying digits. And look, I wasn't going to clip this, but there is a great fuck up here where he is talking about the difference between land sloths and aquatic sloths. You know, see, land sloths drive like this, aquatic sloths drive like this. No, he doesn't, but let's hear it.
Earlier versions of the marine sloth were still covered in a coat of shaggy hair, as they were merely waders who never ventured into deeper waters. In contrast, the marine sloths of the Pliocene were nearly hairless, more streamlined in shape and covered by a layer of insulting blubber.
Yes. That was a real evolutionary insult, man. That offensive blubber. I don't know. I think autocorrect must have got that guy's script, right? And he just plowed through and he's just like,
covered by a layer of insulting blubber.
Like, whoa.
These people are just not even thinking about what they're saying. They're just blindly reading it.
They're just like, he's a fat fuck.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, and it's just, like, it's offensive to everyone. It offends me.
Covered by a layer of insulting blubber.
Oh, get that out of here. Evolve past. No, yeah, that's this guy. But so there could be other explanations for the appearance of this Ninjin. You know, maybe it didn't evolve here on Earth at all. So we've already discussed strangeness surrounding Antarctica. We've had our buddy Creepy Pete from Creepy Little Book on here talking about Antarctica. And some theorize that the Ninjin could be an alien life form. And if so, this guy has a lot of questions.
If the Ninjin really is extraterrestrial in origin, it would create more questions than answers, though. Why did it abandon its former home planet? And how did it travel to ours? Is the Ninjin intelligent? And if so, why did it choose to turn its back on its advanced technology and live as a wild animal in the icy waters of the Antarctic?
Okay, one at a time, you up front. I don't know. It just could just be an animal from another planet if you want to make an alien. I doubt it abandoned any technology. It's like, I don't know. It's
that
like how.
Is this, like before he had mentioned the other theory about mermaids being a stretch. This is a stretch.
How did he get here, though, Russ, if he's just an animal?
It's some alien race is going through their hippie phase of society, and they're like, we're ditching this, man. We're going to Earth, where it's just water
and
ice.
There was
ice.
Aliens involved at some point. There must have been. You're saying there's aliens involved that transported this thing, and they may have just left it here. I was thinking, once again, sounds like E.T. Like
they got left behind?
I hate to steal the line from Larry King, but, you know, that looks like E.T. I think maybe he just got left there. You know?
They probably left
that
him on purpose.
That looks like, that's E.T.
Yeah, but...
covered by a layer of insulting blubber.
That's why they dropped him here.
Oh, no.
They were done with
that's
them.
Different.
Yeah. It'd
be tough if E.T. was covered in a layer
of insulting blubber.
Well, besides being a cryptid, and now a possible alien, the Ninjin is also thought to be part of a conspiracy. This thing checks all the boxes for paranormal. This theory being that the existence of the Ninjin is being kept secret because it does emit a powerful toxin that governments are, I don't know, weaponizing, maybe?
It does sound like it sounds like a government organization, Ninjin. It sounds like they make, like, the weapons that the ninjas use.
That the Yakuzas use, yes. The Yakuzas use the Ninjin. That's where they get their powerful toxins that they blow in their faces.
It's seriously, because it's a G, right? It's a hard G. It's not a J, so.
He says the guy in the video.
I know. I have to go by the guy in the video has become canon now.
I know. So we'll just go for it. It's a ninja. It's a ninja whale sloth UFO ET covered in insulting blubber.
And
we'll
run conspiracy.
With that.
So
Ninjin, Ningen, Ninyen.
You know, exactly.
Now, okay, I get that. I see the conspiracy now. You're so right.
Yeah.
But this is part, no, the conspiracy, though, is that it either lets out some kind of powerful toxin that's going to be a weapon, or it secretes something that has a medical use. And if this is found out, the Ninjin would then be hunted to extinction and used by all kind of different countries. And the elite, they are hiding this miracle creature from us. Both of these scenarios, I don't know, they're kind of suspect, I think. But giant aquatic creatures, they aren't really known for being venomous. That's another thing.
True.
A lot of energy is expended to do that. Like smaller creatures, you know, are mostly known for either being venomous or medicinal. Big giant things. Yeah, they're not really built for that. I don't know.
Except for maybe jellyfish.
I was gonna say, what about a Portuguese man o' war?
Jellyfish.
So yeah, I don't know. What are your thoughts on this first cryptid from Japan, Drea? What do you think about Ningen?
I think that it's possible that there is something weird out there, the same way as, like, you know, Nessie or the lake monsters that get really massive. I don't know where they're getting the idea that they secrete something toxic, unless, like, who's actually touching this thing and finding that out and then telling us, like, oh, but it's a secret and they're keeping it somewhere secret, but people are still seeing it. I don't know.
Yeah, where's the evidence? She wants to know, where is the evidence of the toxin? Like, has anyone actually ever felt like this thing, like, is dangerous? Has anybody had a dangerous encounter with it? Has it killed a pet? Has it done something that we can point at to say this is toxic?
When you stick these stories out in Antarctica and no one can say anything, like, I don't know what's going on. No one's out there patrolling. So anything could be going on out there. And yeah, it could just be creepypasta, but people do have those Google Earth images and some of them are kind of compelling, but I don't know. Is such a thing even possible? Who knows? But let's move on from now, because what do you want to get into next, Drea?
There's so many other weird things going on in Japan besides off in the weird waters. There's like entire classes of, I think, yokai, right, is what they call monsters, or I guess kind of cryptids, because then there's other things like demons and ghosts and whatnot. But there's like this kind of middle ground that I was really fascinated with that pretty much only exists on the mainland, because it's like everyday objects, you know, that kind of become cryptids. This one I'm going to start with is, it's called the Kasa Obake, which is an umbrella ghost.
Yes, it's a very popular. It's a super cute, weird one.
I think. It's a very weird one. And so this is the idea of something that it's an old or broken umbrella that kind of turns into a monster, and it has like one eye, one leg, and one tongue. obviously. I don't know why it would have multiple
umbrella?
Tongues.
It's an umbrella?
It's an umbrella.
It's an umbrella. So this is like a Disney thing. This is like...
It's like a real monster, almost.
Beauty and the Beast kind of shit.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast kind of thing going on here. It's like a singing, dancing umbrella.
Whoa. You're just going to say it sings and dances like that?
It has one leg. It looks like the lamp from A Christmas Story, kind of.
Oh, yeah.
That's what
it kind of
reminds me of.
It kind of does remind me of that. Hey, it's a grand prize.
It's Fragile.
Yeah, it's Italian. Italian, Japanese, African American. So I'm just going to read this description off of the cryptid fandom that I found this particular one on. I love the description of it, so I have to just give it exactly as it says.
Sure.
All right, so it's... There's a bunch of variations. One of it has arms and 2 feet. Ooh. But it's part of this category known as tsukumogami, which are, like I said before, ordinary objects that gain a soul and come to life after 100 years. So they have to be alive for a certain, or around for a certain amount of time.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know why they gain a soul, but this one is pretty harmless, luckily. Enjoys scaring people for fun, licking them.
Oh, weird.
Just goes around licking people, jumping out at them, just for funsies.
It's a little bowl licker.
I forgot about that shit.
Yeah, he's a little licker. That's look at this little guy with his one leg. He's a fucking umbrella who licks people.
Yeah, how would you feel about that? You know, you don't trust any of your umbrellas anymore. I wouldn't. What I kind of like about it is it says there are some people who truly believe that this is really an animated umbrella that will come to life, but I think it's mostly a thing that's told to kids. It says it's mostly thought of as a metaphor used to explain how objects gain character and personality, aka a soul, as they age.
Okay.
Often meant to discourage thoughtless disposal of objects that have a long history and still have use within them. So kind of like Brave Little Toaster.
I like that. I like that idea of holding on, and actually it makes you want to actually take care of something. But I don't know if you're scaring kids with saying, hey, if you really take care of stuff and keep it around for a long time, it might come to life and lick you one day. The toaster's like, going to come give you a kiss in the bathtub one night. You know, it's like, no.
Hopefully not plugged in.
I wonder where the licking thing came from.
It is. Like, I don't know who came up with this, right? Unless it's real and it just is what it does.
Unless it happened just one time. There's this one weird circumstance. Like, a bunch of things all happened at the right moment and for somehow a fucking umbrella came to life and it licked somebody.
Yeah, the umbrella's tongue is that little strap that you use to snap it closed. That's its tongue.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. That actually kind of makes sense.
Great. That's good, Russ. This is why
I'm on it.
The host of the show. Because he's got this sort of information for us.
Although, if you look at the picture of it, it's drawn in the... This came from like the old Japan, you know? Like you look at the style of this drawing, like the ink and everything that's painted. It's like those paper parasols.
I was going to say, Rob's giving me all these props. I'm like, it's probably a paper umbrella that looks like something that you would stick in a giant cocktail, right?
Yeah, basically.
Kind of.
That would be fun if we just take those little cocktail umbrellas and put a googly eye and draw a tongue.
There you go. Oh, wow. That's going to be merch.
All right. Etsy store right there. We're going to make some poorly knitted ninjins that are very easy to make and some cocktail umbrellas with tongues. And they're coming to you.
I bet we could make ninjins out of socks quicker.
Wow. Oh my God. I can't wait to order these things. I'm going to
Amazon
cut
this out.
As soon as we're done.
Cut this out. Then we're going to use this.
This is going to be great. Cool. I like this guy. This is the first time we've ever had like an inanimate object.
Well, there was that one thing in Florida that got chased
Japan
at the time.
Shit, man.
What?
I mean, we've got this umbrella, right? And then we have a very similar one that I had to bring up because I think it hits a particular part of our lore and mist here in the Unbelievers podcast. This is the Chochin Obake, which is a lantern. It's a possessed lantern that has the one eye and the one tongue and everything, and it goes around licking people too.
It's kind of in the same vein as the umbrella. That is definitely a bigger sentient
floating lantern.
It goes around licking people as well?
It's funny that you guys mentioned too the whole slit for a mouth thing, because this one says when a paper lantern or chochin reaches an advanced age, it sometimes becomes this thing with the paper will split along the wooden ribs. You know those paper lanterns? How they look? They're kind of like oval shaped or whatever. So that will split along one of the ribs and that turns into the mouth with a crazy wild tongue. And then one or two eyes pop out of the upper half of the lantern.
That's a floating lantern. You're not getting away from me.
I was about to ask, is Little Hatchie a Japanese term? Maybe it was a Japanese cemetery in Florida where that guy was seeing floating lanterns chasing him around? I guess
I wish.
I don't
Honestly,
think
Honestly, I
so.
Wish.
No. that would be crazy if there was actually some sort of a weird connection.
Like, I'm only asking questions.
Oh, I know. But now, I mean, now that I know what this thing looks like, I mean, I've seen it before, but I completely, completely forgot about this. And when I saw it, I knew it was perfect. Now, every time I hear that clip, I'm going to be picturing this thing with a fucking crazy googly eye and a weird tongue.
See, that's why, Japan Cribs is so great. We don't get things like this here. If anything like that happens here, it's, you know, chalked up to poltergeist activity. We don't have any kind of folklore about really inanimate objects doing anything on their
own.
It's
not as fun.
Unless, you know, somehow the spiritualism movement, like Ouija boards and stuff like that, is brought in. But then again, you're getting poltergeist. Even, I don't think the lanterns or the umbrellas are really that supernatural, but they do seem to more like be actual personality, being more sentient than haunted.
Yeah, exactly. And it's what I really enjoy about this and these kinds of creatures is the, I guess, that they're not threatening, that they're harmless mostly. These ones,
mostly,
anyway.
Except for the licking, which I think just might be more of like a hentai thing. You know, I feel like there's like
hope
a.
Not. Oh, so you do.
There's
know.
No tentacles involved here, Rob. This is not
what
like,
we. I don't know anime. I've never watched
tentacle lantern.
But he knows what hentai is.
I mean, I hear things. I pay attention.
I'm on the internet. What do you want from me?
Yeah, I'm a child of the internet. I believe that it is called hentai, and I believe.
From what I've heard.
From what I've heard. There's often a lot of this tongue business going on.
Octopus.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like there's something weird about the tongue, a little sexual thing going on there. Don't really know why.
Yeah. Actually, I think I misspoke about this one. This one doesn't actually lick people. He just he likes to surprise people, scare them, and he laughs and just rolls his eyes and rolls the tongue at them, just like blah. Like a weird face, you know?
Okay.
Like being silly.
That seems like something you'd run into at the Haunted Museum or something. Or the Haunted Mansion, sorry. Whatever, the same thing. They're both theme parks, basically.
Museum, yeah.
They're basically both theme parks. Zach Baggins has his theme park. So does Walt Disney.
Because you look at this thing, you can't be scared. It's actually really freaking cute. I think it's adorable.
It looks like something from, like, Roger Rabbit, you know?
Yeah.
It's kind of got, like, all
very
these things
cartoony.
Are very, like, Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Sort of, which is fun. I love that movie, and I wish inanimate objects were alive. I think that'd be cool. If, like, just my guitar could just be alive if I wanted it to be. Or,
oh,
like,
unless it's a jerk. Imagine that it just has nothing
me.
But bad shit to say.
No,
it's
you
like,
play
you
tasty
play
licks
right.
on it. That's the licks
oh,
you
that's
do on
true.
Your guitar.
Yeah, right.
Man.
The
Come
guitar
on.
Does. Yeah, it's
worth
the
licks.
Licking.
Yeah,
it needs the licks.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
all I'm going to touch on this for now. I mean, there are other things out there, inanimate objects. There's sandals that have the same kind of thing going on. Sometimes they have legs and arms and run around, but they generally
sandals?
Are just, yeah. Two
that's because someone
even.
Lost one of their sandals and they were like,
oh, they walked away. I didn't lose anything. Yeah. They didn't take off.
Came alive and it left.
This was in my family for four generations, 100-year-old sandals that, you know, just enough time for them to just take off and get a mind of their own. I love these
that
things.
That is how they've, yeah, that's how they've ended up rationalizing when things end up disappearing or whatever. It's because they gained a soul and literally left.
Like underpants gnomes.
Yes, exactly. But
they'll
yeah.
figure out that profit part at some point. Those lanterns and umbrellas and sandals. All right. I've got another elusive Japanese cryptid. And this is another fairly recent one. And this is something I'd like to talk about called the Chisai Ojisan, or for us English speakers, the Tiny Old Man. And according to legend, in the year 2009, people began to report sightings of a small, middle-aged man standing about 8 to 20 centimeters high, dressed in a green tracksuit and having a noticeably receding hairline. This is the Tiny Old Man, also called the Little Uncle.
Aww.
The Little Uncle.
This is the Little
I don't know
Uncle.
Which one I hate worse.
So there have been sightings of this guy. You would either call him Tiny Old Man or the Little Uncle. Imagine this, a 8 to whatever, 20 centimeter middle-aged Japanese man in a green tracksuit with the white stripes and a receding hairline. And there have been sightings of them sticking to windows, sightings of them in bathrooms, and
ew.
Carrying empty cans on the roadside and also on trees in parks. All typical things middle-aged men,
I feel like
tiny or not,
you
like
see
to
a
do.
Little, just because you see a little old man doesn't mean he's a cryptid. I don't know.
Well, I think he means like tiny. They're not
side of the road.
But he is tiny. He is not.
Yeah, how small?
This is not very small. Very small. I'm talking, you know, centimeters small.
Inches.
He's very, very small. Like the littles. Almost very small. And there's a bunch of websites and bulletin boards that have like posting sections about the small uncles is a key term you can find in Japan.
Small uncles.
Small uncles.
A TV presenter named Akio Siki, who is known for telling urban legends, said on the TV program Yarasugi Kozi on March 15th, 2009, that, quote, fairies follow the worshippers of shrines in the central Kanto region, and small uncle is also there. And actor Koji Motoba, he said that he often visits this shrine, and although the name of the shrine was not included in this program, it is a shrine that is in the center of Tokyo. And there are rumors that Omiya Hachimangu Shrine in Suginami, that is the home of the little old man and possibly little old men. There could be more than one of them. And during consecutive holidays in March of that year, immediately after they broadcast this story, the shrine had doubled its normal worshipers and has gradually increased, and the shrine has become very popular as the home of the little old man.
Great. Man. Good for them.
Is he a leprechaun?
Now you're getting close. You're getting a little bit. You're getting close to it. So, because in 2010, he got his first merch. There was a mobile phone strap called, quote, a small uncle who calls happiness. And this was released, and it was advertised that if you see a small uncle, that you will receive a small happiness. And if you see this, you will succeed. And yes, he is like a Japanese leprechaun. He is dressed in
green. A little bit of luck.
He's dressed in green.
He's like the little guy. A little bit of luck. Remember him? The lotto guy?
Yes, he's got a little bit of luck, but he wears green, and he's just a little guy. And yes, this is the equivalent. I know St. Patrick's Day has just recently passed, but this is your equivalent of the Japanese leprechaun. He's very new. He's the little uncle.
Little uncle. He's a little bit of luck. He's like a little... Where does he, what does he do? What's his thing?
Well, he's seen, you know, in bathrooms and trees and stuff like that, but he also appears most frequently to children. But however, he is also known to appear before tired adults who become overworked or fallen ill. And he often gives the advice or the consolation of a loving parent. He's a kind of like a loving, nice guy.
Aww.
He's known to kindly consolidate children who are crying or upset. And encounters with the old man are generally delightful, but brief. Because
interesting,
as soon as he gives his advice and makes either a tired person or a sad child better, he is spotted jogging about in his green jumpsuit, and he waves goodbye and he says, "Take care," in his tiny, distant voice. And yes, that is what the little old man is up to in Japan. He's giving luck. He's consoling people. He's a very positive cryptid.
Wow.
That's great. I mean, I think I would have been freaked out initially if I had seen something like that, but knowing this now ahead of time, I won't freak out if I see a tiny uncle.
He looks weird. There was one picture I saw of him. It looked like he was on like an ATM machine or something.
That is one of that is one of the pictures. There was also a picture from
getting
the early 70s that people think was an early spotting of the small uncle that people didn't realize until later.
Very large head.
Yeah, he's got a pretty big head. But it's also because he's balding a little bit, so you see more of the dome. You know, it makes your head look a little bigger. But he's not nice all the time, because occasionally he's said to be pulling pranks or also having the mouth of a sailor who'll curse at you. He's sometimes he can have a foul mouth.
He was nice.
He was just so nice like 5 seconds ago.
It might be to mean people, I don't know. But they're rarely
is
seen
he
for
bipolar?
Long. Because yes, he's got a tracksuit on for a reason. He likes to hightail it out of there. And the second the second you pull out the camera, he's like, "Take care," and he
Fuck
is
you,
gone.
Bye.
He is very fast.
Wow.
That's why getting a picture of him is a very hard thing to pull off.
There's a tree that I have to go hang out in.
Take care. I've got to go to the shrine and whatever he's doing there. And there's not a lot of info about the little uncle, but I had to bring him. And I did find something. I even like scoured Reddit to see if anyone was talking about the little uncle there. And I found one account of a little uncle from Reddit. And it says, quote, "This girl I know swears she saw one in a classroom when she was a kid. She said it had been messing up the classroom and she caught him in the act. Then later her teacher wouldn't believe it was a little man, but she absolutely insists to this day she really did see him."
Wow.
"I know it's bullshit, but she's so insistent. I think this might be a deal breaker for us. I wouldn't want her teaching our kids this bullshit." All right, I don't know where that comment went at the end. But someone does swear that they have seen a little man running around in a green suit.
Oh, damn.
Man.
Well, I'm glad that somebody has, like, well, at least there's a story. Of course, they could be making it up, but.
Well, it was brought up on television in Tokyo. That's kind of how it it got initially, like, you know, this urban legend show was talking about sightings of, like, our equivalent of, I don't know, Paranormal Caught on Tape or whatever in Japan in the 2000s.
Which is mostly 99% complete horse shit. But I want to believe that there is a little tiny guy running around in a tracksuit saying uplifting things in a very foul mouth.
Yeah, and then going up to kids and just being nice to them 5 minutes later.
Giving them cash.
He's all over the place. I love this guy because he's unpredictable. You never know what you're getting
from a little
old man.
He's chaotic good.
Yeah. He's a little uncle. You know, who knows what he's going to do.
My tiny uncle.
You got to make sure you keep an eye on him because he's little. He's sneaky. Who knows where he's going? He might sneak. He goes in the bathroom.
He sneaks in the bathroom.
Yeah, I don't really care for that part.
You don't want him in the bathroom while you're in there.
Get out of the bathroom.
Me.
I know, right?
You wouldn't believe how I even found out about this. He's pretty obscure. I found out of him because of rods. Because someone sent me, there's a small set of statues you can buy. And it's a little small Mothman statue, a small Nessie statue, a small skyfish statue, which is rods in Japan. Of course, they're known as skyfish. But the skyfish comes with a little guy. And it turned out to be the little uncle. It's a little statue of the little uncle you can get with a skyfish. And that's kind of how I kind of came across this. And there's a couple little cool designs of the little uncle you can find. I saw a great sticker of him running. It looks like he's waving at you. And he's got his green tracksuit on. Pretty cool stuff. I don't know. It's hard to say. Maybe the only way to find out if he's real is to go to Japan and maybe work very hard and get very tired and, I don't know, maybe be sad and hopefully the little uncle will come
to
you.
Sit on a bench.
Overwork yourself at a sad job. Wait. Yeah. Go to the bathroom.
I love that now we have Goat Man, we have Mothman, and now we have little old man.
Tiny old man, yes.
He's just tiny old man.
Yeah, you said there weren't going to be men, like blank man. Now we have tiny old man. You lied.
Yeah. It's great, though. This is a weird one. And maybe it's, you know, green tracksuit. What are the chances? It was just St. Patrick's Day.
Yeah, it's green and white. White striped green. Yeah, he's got the, he could be the official Japanese leprechaun, their version of a
fae. I believe he is.
But he just looks like a middle-aged Japanese man, and he's just very tiny.
He's got all
but proportionate. He's not like a dwarf or anything, right? He's not like the leprechaun. He's not scary.
Proportionate. I saw the size of that head, Russ.
Yeah,
that was the first word that came to my mind. Fine. But he gives you luck, green suit, hides in trees, leprechaun. I'm calling it now.
All right. Yeah, I don't know if we're not making these things fight either. We're just presenting this tonight.
No,
this is
maybe
not
someday.
Maybe
someday,
one of these
but
days.
Not right now.
But not tonight.
Don't have time for
so,
that right now.
All right. But Drea, I believe you have another great Japanese cryptid for us. Yes.
Yeah, I've got a few more. It's funny. Another thing that you had mentioned before was like, oh, we're not going to have, you know, dog man and frog man, all these men. No, but this is going to be jam packed full of women because there's a bunch of these yokai who are women.
Good.
Yeah. Oh, Rob, I hope you say that excited throughout all of this. So we've got.
I take it back. I totally take it back. Now I regret it.
Yeah, the ones I talked about before were very benign, and these ones are less so. We've got Nure Ona, Iso Ona, and Kuchisake Ona, and Nure Onago. Two of them are very similar, so I'm going to lump them together. They translate to coast woman and wet woman. So it just means that they're. Okay. Constantly, yeah, right? Sounds good. They're dripping with water all the time.
that's what they say. I don't know.
Their habitats are, you know, for the coast woman, obviously coast. What about the wetness?
Smell it.
I forget how long that is.
So we've got their habitats are coasts, particularly rocky ones, and the other one, Nure Ona, which is... she's a little bit, she's got the head of a woman, but like the body of a snake. She's very reptilian, serpentine. Sometimes they have arms, sometimes they don't.
And I'm saying, is that a head?
Sorry.
Actually, that's what I was going to ask. This is more like in the cryptid verse where they've got like these animal bodies. Because I'm picturing Ringu with the kind of the wet female
spirit. Yeah, that seems to be a common theme with that kind of horror for some reason. And I think it actually is related to this kind of thing where they, besides their habitat, it says their diet is blood. So they're kind of like, these ones are vampires,
what?
Basically. Yeah, so the Nure Ona is the one that's looking like the snake. She's got a forked tongue and everything. And she'll pretend to, like, they're physically stronger than people, and sometimes they can be gigantic, but they like to trick people instead of just using brute force. So they can appear looking all, like, sad or distressed, like carrying a baby, and they're crying for help for anybody to stop by. And when they do, you know, they're like, here, hold my baby for a second, I'm fucking tired. And if they agree and take it, the quote-unquote baby, it says, becomes heavy as a boulder, and the victim is unable to move, and then they attack and drink all their blood.
See, this sounds like skinwalker kind of tactics, almost like the water babies, the tricking people.
The trickery,
going through the trouble to trick people into killing themselves.
That's
almost.
That's crazy. They're like, hold my baby. And they're like,
just kidding.
Psych, I'm a snake.
Right? And then so this other one, the Isa Ona, which is just coast woman, for some reason is mostly on the coast. But same thing. They always appear as a beautiful woman who's just come out of the water, dripping wet, hair is long and matted, reaching all the way to the sand, it says. Wow. And then, and this is an exact quote from this particular. They have a very fun way of writing about these things. Their eyes are heavy with sultry sexual energy, and their nearly transparent wet clothes stick to their skin. Like, okay. This sounds like they've been there, right? You would totally get sucked in by one of these things, Rob. Because soon as you get close enough, they fucking
some moist
kill
tart
you.
Coming out of the water? No, I don't think Rob would fall for that.
It is written like it's like a sexual romance novel, like in the way that they describe what they're wearing, the translucent clothing.
Yeah, I think this
clothing.
Person has a thing for them, for sure.
Yeah, I think they want to fuck one of these things.
Right?
I mean, if you're going to have an experience such as this, I mean, I guess you could do a lot worse. You could be dealing with, I don't know, I guess a little old man wouldn't be worse than this. But
I don't know. It seems a lot easier to deal with.
Well, right, this is the first one so far we talked about that with any kind of violent end to it.
Yeah, yeah, which is interesting. So you could do better than that, you know, or worse, depending on how you feel about this next one. This is Nure Onago, which is translation, wet girl, as opposed to woman, okay. Or alternate name, wet bride. She, what the habitat says, water sides, wetlands, fishing villages, anywhere near water. But her diet, it says, is attention. So that was very intriguing to me.
All the spectrum of female here is represented. Yeah, right. We've got the snake woman. We've got the one who just wants the attention. All right, I see where we're going.
She's just all about the likes. That's all it is. She's just in it for the likes.
It gets kind of sad so they show up, you know, as a disheveled looking girl who's just like, same thing, wet, matted hair. Who's like, oh my gosh, she needs help. You know, this is pathetic. Sometimes like stuck with.
But what about the wetness?
Dead leaves and things stuck to them.
See, that's not as helpful as having like a sheer outfit on that's wet that they're already talking about. Oh, it's translucent.
No, yeah, because this is a girl. You can't.
This is a little. So she's just they just throw a bunch of junk on her. Like, no, you can't see anything.
So what happens when you meet one of these people instead of just seeing like, oh no, this person needs help? Like it says most people who witness such a pathetic sight rush over to help the poor girl. But when a person draws near, she'll look up into their eyes and smile. If the smile is returned, she will follow the helpful stranger, sticking by him forever. And so you would think like, oh, that's great for people who are lonely and, you know, need a girlfriend or somebody to just follow him around forever like a cat. But it says it's not as nice as it seems since they will continually drip water and they stink of mildew and swamp water.
Yeah, I was about to say, even without that, it seemed like a bit much of a commitment to have this... But yeah, knowing that they're just forever wet, forever just smelling musky, I guess. I don't know, musty.
Yeah. It says, although she causes no particular harm, just her constant presence is often enough to ruin the rest of a person's life. So
So imagine that all the time, everywhere that you are.
I don't want to, Mr. Vampire, bringing it back to that. Right. I thought you were going to play he said blood or whatever earlier.
Blood. I always forget. There's so many clips now. I forget that we have a blood clip.
Long story short, they ended up draining that guy's blood for something.
That's from Paranormal Gumbo. We got way too many clips. That's not the right one.
But yeah, that's moving along. It seems like a bad deal, but a good deal as far as all the like really crazy, scary shit out there. But it's really sad when you think about the moral of the story being like, don't smile back at a stranger who looks like they're down on their luck.
Yeah, that seems like the good outcome, though. What if you don't? What if you frown at them? Are you dead?
I don't know. It just says ignoring one is and refusing to return her smile is the only way to avoid this one.
So there you go, Russ.
Just don't smile at
fucking
girls.
Smile at
I can't. I'm just like a smile talker, too. I can't. Like, I'd just be smiling already seeing her.
Right? I know. What if you smile first, and then she's like, I don't know what to do about that. And
gotcha.
She's got an infectious smile. You can't help yourself but from smiling. So
God, and that reminds me. I wasn't even going to talk about this one, but what you just mentioned reminded me of one that I had read about called, I think it was Warai Ona, who's like, it means laughing woman. And if you run into them in the woods, they look at you and like, point and laugh, and then it's same thing, an infectious laugh, and you can't stop laughing, and then you come down with a fever, and then you die within a few days because you won't stop laughing.
Right, it's like watching that laughing yoga for way too long, where you just, that psychotic laugh.
It's like
laughing.
What'll happen if you listen to this show too much. You'll just die from laughing eventually.
Yeah, I think I'd be okay with that in this particular case.
Hey, if you gotta go, like, I mean, come on. What you're getting into. Do worse.
That is the best way to die. That's how I want to die.
Right? Die laughing. It's the second best to like dying during sex or whatever. A lot of people want to go that way. I know. That actually sounds horrible. But
yeah. No. This is crazy.
Impossible. So
you got the wet girl who she smiles at you. You smile back, and then you're just stuck with
her.
Stinky, stinky wet girl following you around forever, which is the worst. And then this other one. This is weird. These are some interesting.
It's cool.
I've got one more. This one's the creepiest one. And it's funny, again, about the slit for her mouth. This one apparently has a slit for her mouth. What? It's what her name means, Kuchisake Onna, or the slit-mouthed woman. I'm just going to read it straight up. It's definitely one of the deadlier beings on this list. And
she's in the phallosucket also genus, Rob.
I don't know.
I love how you don't like these terms, and we're just presenting to you. These are true terms.
Coochie Sakamoris? Is that what you said?
Kuchisake Onna, which I know Kuchi, I think, is mouth. I'm pretty sure that's what that word means. Anyway, so she conceals her face.
I don't think
so,
but keep going.
It is. I know a little bit of Japanese. She conceals her face with a fan or mask and wields a sharp weapon like scissors or a knife. It's said that she asks people whether they think she's attractive. If you say no, she'll kill you immediately. If you say yes, she'll remove the mask to show her mutilated face and then ask the question again. And you'll die if you say no this time. But if you say yes, then she'll cut the corners of your mouth to resemble hers. Ouch! It literally says ouch in
like
this article.
Cute, like thing at the end, like ouch.
Ouchie. Ouchie.
You want to know how I got these stitches? It's very complicated. I was in Japan and I met this wet. Is she wet also?
No, this one's not wet. So that's great. She's not dripping with
not
water.
Not wet.
But she's
not
masked. Okay.
Heath Ledger thing going on. Kind of.
However, yeah. I mean, it does
politeness is a
sense.
Thing in Japanese folklore and with, as far as cryptids go too, it seems to be a moral with a few of them. And this definitely seems like one. You should definitely be polite. If someone asks you if they're attractive, go, yes, you are very, very attractive. Please keep your mask on.
Yeah, but she will show you her face and ask you again. So it sounds like you're kind of damned if you do, damned if you don't. But there is one way, allegedly, that you can get out of it. It says, according to lore, you can try to escape the slit-mouthed woman by telling her she looks average. Or try bribing her with money or candy. So that's the moral
that
of the story.
That probably does work. The
money
second
and
thing,
the candy.
The second part. The first one, I do not recommend.
She looks okay. Yeah, right? She'll totally kill you if you say she just looks average.
Do not recommend that, ever. That's probably not the best way to ever talk to a woman. The food thing is 100% on point, though. Candy and food, that definitely does work. So... Yeah.
That is the best. If any woman just asks you if you think that they're attractive, just give her money without saying a word.
Yeah, get skinwalker-ish where you give it a skippity-bop-bop, you throw your corn and your tobacco down, you smash it up a little
Here's
bit.
Here's your corn, enjoy.
Or just take a cookie and just slide it right into her little slit mouth. And then
like a thin mint. A thin mint would work. You know I think the Japanese would like thin mints.
Out,
I think
it's like when you're trying to put a dollar in the vending machine and she spits it back out. Like,
yeah,
you
exactly.
need to flatten it out better.
Literally designed. It's like a CD player. You know what I mean? Like, just put that thing in there.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's it for me with these fucking creepy women cryptids.
Women.
They're not real
These
humans.
Women cryptids. Yes.
And it's something that I've always harped on. Even in the beginning, I mentioned Mothman, Dogman, Lizardman. They're always man. There's never Mothwoman, Lizardwoman. I'm so glad you brought these.
Many.
You have to go... you know, all the way across the ocean to be able to find these great kind of tales of these female cryptids. But let's get into our final cryptid creature from the land of the rising sun. And this This is not new. This is a very ancient one. This is not like the Ninjin or Little Old Man who just kind of jumped on the scene very recently. This is a creature from Japanese folklore known as the Kappa. And I will give you guys a brief description of the Kappa from that cryptid wiki we all love. It's a great source for all things cryptid. It says, Kappas are typically depicted as roughly humanoid in form and about the size of a child. Their scaly reptilian skin ranges in color from green to yellow or blue. And despite the reptilian features, Kappas are said to have ape-like faces and scraggly green hair. So these Kappas kind of start imagining now. They supposedly inhabit ponds and rivers of Japan, and they have various features that aid in this environment, such as they got webbed feet and hands, and they are sometimes said to smell like fish. I don't know if they taste like fish. They certainly smell like that.
Great. Yeah,
that's a cue right there for me. So here you go.
It tastes like fish.
And yes, but if they smell or taste like fish, then they certainly swim like fish, because there's a popular expression known as Kappa no Kawanagare, which means a kappa drowning in a river. And it's supposed to convey the idea that even experts make mistakes. So the Kappa is even like a colloquialism in Japan, the fact that this is an excellent swimmer. And one of their most unique features is the top of their heads, which we're going to hear about in this clip from a short Kappa documentary.
Strangely, they have a concave head, which would have almost seemed like some kind of rain dish. And this part is quite clever and creative, because if that rain dish isn't containing water when they leave the water, then they can't move. So it's almost like a life support system for them while they're not submerged. In most folklore, they're described as being very polite. So if a children is about to be attacked, if he or she bows first, the Kappa is just too much of an extreme gentleman and has to bow as well. Obviously, once it bows, the water will pour out of its head and it won't be able to move. So I think right there is the disciplinary part of the folklore. A lot of folklore and fables are designed to discipline children. So in this case, it's obviously promoting being polite, bowing, being courteous. Bow, otherwise you die.
Yeah, so the Kappa have bowls in their heads. And I know we love bowls, so I found this fascinating. So imagine the top of their head is a bowl-shaped thing where they have to keep this water in there, as you heard it, but they can be forced to bow. And
bow, otherwise you die.
I love that he was described as an extreme gentleman.
My forehead's repelling the bowl. I don't know how he does it.
There it is. I knew we had bowls on heads or bowls on face got a clip.
I don't know. I try to get it to stick and it just never, it repels it. I don't know how he does it. He's got it built into
him. He's built the fuck in, and now people just keep on ejaculating into it.
Oh, no. That's
think about that, right?
It does look like he's like got like a Friar Tuck haircut. You know what I mean? Like he's like a balding in the middle kind
of. It's a literal bowl cut. Like he cannot avoid it. His head is a bowl, but he does have like scraggly hair around it. So the folklore of Kappa, it is like that guy was saying, mostly a cautionary tale. It's to frighten kids and to make them be polite or risk being killed by this Kappa, who I'm going to say right now, this Kappa looks very similar to the aliens that Kyle Odom drew. Those Ninja Turtle-looking aliens. And I'm going to give you guys some more Kappa facts. So Kappas are usually seen as mischievous troublemakers, and their pranks range from the relatively innocent, such as loudly passing gas or looking up women's kimonos, to the malevolent, such as drowning people in animals or kidnapping children. And when these Kappas attack, they often pull the person's intestines out through their anus in order to get to a mythical organ called the Shirakodama, which is said to contain the human soul. So these guys, on a most extreme level, are trying to find a secret organ in your ass that holds your soul.
That's where the radiation settles.
Yeah.
We know that radioactivity settles in the anus.
So that makes sense that your spirit would probably be there too.
Yeah. So these things are kind of like your the Fae. Yeah, but they're just into way more fucked up stuff, right, Drea?
Yeah. That's what Japan's got to do. Just take it to the next level, man. Man, what's really going on out there in Japan? Oh, we're taking it to the next level.
They really are. They're ripping your guts out through your fucking butthole. That's how bad. You know what he kind of looks like? He looks like, remember Toka and Rezar from Secret of the Ooze, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2.
Oh,
kind of like looks like him.
Man, good memory with the names.
If he was like a cryptid and he had a bowl on his head, like a flatter head. But that's who he reminds me of. Just want to throw that out there.
So I have to ask you guys a question real quick. Do you guys like cucumbers?
Love them.
Yes, I love cucumbers, but now I'm afraid that I'm not going to.
Well, how do you like these cucumbers? Because the Kappa is also very interested in cucumbers as well. People can sometimes escape from an aggressive Kappa by throwing a cucumber in its direction and then run away while it eats a cucumber.
You better have cucumbers on you then, I guess.
You should.
I always do.
You could give them to
I don't go anywhere without my cucumbers.
Wet or dry women.
People always ask me, they're like, is that a cucumber in your pocket or are you just happy to see me? And I'm like, it's just a cucumber.
It's both.
I carry them all the time in my pocket.
It comes in handy though, because if you for some reason, Rob or Drea, if you find yourself having to bathe in the water that a Kappa might live in, you can bring a cucumber with you, and if you throw it in the water before you get in there, you should be okay. It should allow you to use the water. It's not going to attack you. And
how long does it take to eat the cucumber before it is like not distracted anymore?
Long enough.
Yeah. You know? How long does it take you to eat a cucumber, Dre? Probably like a half hour to go through a whole one if it's a real big one.
Yeah, they're child really size hungry. As well. They probably don't have the hugest
child
appetite.
Child size cucumbers?
Yeah.
Cucumbers are a big part of this because it says it's also possible to befriend a Kappa by bringing it cucumbers, which will also cause it to help in other ways.
And I like that.
They can teach you things, though. They believe that the technique of bone setting was thought to have been originally taught to humans by a friendly Kappa, who was obviously offered cucumbers. Yeah. And they are.
What?
That's so fucking random. They swim.
What's the backstory on that one? I need to know.
Right?
That.
That's
they're
so
just,
bizarre.
They're knowledgeable. We don't know why. They like to frequently challenge humans to sumo wrestling, which.
Oh, no.
They're almost guaranteed to win. Unless the human gets to spill the water in their head, and then the Kappa is forced to retreat. So you have...
Wait. So I did kind of forget already what happens when they lose the water in their bowl head.
They lose their powers. They're kind of almost defeated. They have to go and
weakened.
Fill their bowl up. Yeah, they can't really do anything.
Yeah, you have to refill your bowl head. What a bizarre creature.
There's even a type of sushi that contains cucumbers named after Kappa. It's called the Kappa Monkey. If you've ever had a Kappa Maki roll, that is named after the Kappa.
And I just realized, too, I was just looking up the Kappa here, that there's actually a character in Animal Crossing based on the Kappa. It looks like his name is Cap'n. And he's designed to look like the Kappa.
Like a turtle man with a bowl.
Sure. Go find him. Become friends with him. Invite him to your island.
Get him on your island, make sure you're farming cucumbers. And I mentioned their resemblance to those Kyle Odom hypersexual Martian aliens, but look, I'm not the only one that's making this type of connection. Much like the Ninjin, this cryptid could be a visitor to our planet, mainly because of that bowl on their head.
Of this. So that leads people to believe that this was maybe the ancient Japanese people trying to simplify some kind of alien technology that allowed them to live on our planet. I mean, if an alien did come from a planet where it was mostly water or liquid, then they'd need something like that, wouldn't they? The stealing of the children as well. There's that whole idea of alien abduction and experimentation. And as disturbing as it sounds, a little kid is probably the best thing to test on because it has years to grow and can be studied for a much longer time than an adult. But of course, the bowing thing is quite weird. That seems a pretty strange weakness for an extraterrestrial being to have. You simply bow and it does the same and then it's incapacitated.
Yeah, that is definitely a very big weakness, but you heard him. These alien Kappas, they like them young. I was like, what are you even talking about? Ugh. Like,
I didn't like that detail at all.
He's like,
come to think of it, if you're going to abduct someone, you might as well get them young and keep them long, long time.
Yeah, the fact that guy was having those, like he drew those conclusions to that was like, I'm not saying that guy is a predator, but he sure thinks like one.
Yeah, he took us places we weren't expecting to go.
Oh, definitely.
To go to, yeah.
Now that kids could get a Kappa to spill that bowl a lot easier than an adult. They run around and try to chase them at the bend over. You know, that bowl is
stop, drop, and roll.
Yeah,
they can't get you.
Yeah, bowing is a problem for this guy. That's
they're too extreme of a gentleman. They have
that's
to
tough
do
in
it.
Japan, man. It's pretty tough to be from Japan and not be
you
able
think
to bow.
They would just evolve a certain trait of rudeness, right, for survival's sake?
Of all the countries that this kappa had to land in, so one country where people happen to bow, and he has a bowl on his head filled with water that's going to keep him alive, you know. And it is ironic that we've talked about this, and this is from the YouTube documentary from a channel called All Things Creepy, living up to his name. And here's the next clip here. I did like this observation about aliens and weaknesses involving water.
But still, it kind of reminds me of the alien from Signs, if you remember that. But the opposite. So that alien had a really kind of pathetic weakness as well. All you had to do was put water on it and it died. And this one, it's the opposite. All it has to do is lose water from this tiny container on its head and it can't move.
Yeah, great observation there, props. Yes, water is definitely involved in both of these.
Yeah, it's funny to me too about the whole Signs aliens. They chose to try to invade a planet that is mostly water, really. More water than not.
I'm looking at this creature and I'm seeing this bull head and I'm wondering where this thing's brain is. And I'm also wondering where this YouTube man's brain is.
Well, they think your soul is in your ass already. Who the fuck knows where their brain is?
His analogy here to compare this thing to the alien from Signs, I don't really know what he's trying to say.
It's totally stupid. I know. It's nothing so to do dumb. With it.
They have nothing else to talk
aliens
about.
And water. Hey, you remember Signs? Yes, we all remember. Swing it away.
Yeah, swing away. We were there. We did that. Yeah. It is a strange thing that it's like reversed, I guess, in a weird way. That water gives this thing power. But it's like a turtle monster, so of course it does. They thrive in the water.
Definitely.
They're born in it.
And look, this guy and us, we aren't the only ones making alien connections with the kappa. The creature was even featured on everyone's favorite History Channel program, one of Rob's favorites, Ancient Aliens. Yes, the kappa was featured in episode 7 of season 8 of Ancient Aliens, where they feature some physical evidence that points to the existence of a kappa. I don't know, is it a bowl? A mummified cucumber? Who knows? But I did leave in their description of the kappa because it adds a few details that we have not heard yet.
Nagasaki Prefecture, Japan, May 2014. At the historic Byakanojo Shimazu residence, the mummified remains of a sea animal with webbed hands and feet are put on public display. Discovered in 1818, the bones are the first of their kind to be exhibited and are purported to be from the legendary kappa.
The kappa, which translates as water child, is a creature that is usually about 5 feet in height, has scaly skin, and is usually blue or green in color. It has a turtle shell on its back and a beak, as well as a kind of plate on the top of its head in which it always has to carry water. If it spills this water, then it loses all of its power and it can die within a very short period of time.
So it has a turtle shell. It has a beak. It is going to die. It is essentially...
He describes it as a giant turtle shell.
Yes, it is essentially Turtle Man with a bowl, though.
Right.
Water boy.
So there's no turtle women. It's they're all dudes?
Yeah, I know.
That's probably female kappa.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I said we weren't getting there. Maybe we are.
Imagine, but how do they even reproduce when you think of it that way, though? Because they can't spill that water.
They're aliens, I guess. That's what they're going for. This is Ancient Aliens is being featured here. But the big part is
that.
they have mummified remains, though, of a webbed hand. That's
of course
supposed to
they
be,
do.
That's supposed to be... it is on display. So they're going to talk about some modern sightings of the kappa, and we get to hear from someone we haven't talked about in quite a while. This is our old Secret Space Program buddy, David Wilcock, talking about kappas.
While accounts of the kappa are rare in modern times, there are still sightings in remote areas, like the Fukuoka Prefecture. In fact, to this day, signs can be found posted near bodies of water throughout Japan, warning of the kappa. For ancient astronaut theorists, the kappa are not only real, but their existence is proof of otherworldly beings inhabiting the Earth's waters.
These kappa are reported as having an unusual intelligence. Apparently, they can speak even though they have a bird-like beak. And now, physical, tangible artifacts of the body of the kappa have gone on display. Will we find genetic markers that clearly show that it could not be something from Earth?
Boy, David Wilcox sounded great talking about Kappa. I feel like I haven't heard his voice in so long. He sounds so believable there.
Yeah. Sure. I mean, even though they have bird-like mouth, they can speak. And that makes you wonder, how?
Well, he was all in those blue avians, so he knows birds can speak to us anyway.
Yeah, parrots. I know about parrots, but are they talking or are they just making sounds that sound like words? I don't know. There's a fine line there. The Kappa's
well, they
out
said
here.
That they have an actual intelligence. Well, that's what he said anyway. Like, I don't know how he knows that, but...
He doesn't know any of this. I don't know why he's saying this, yeah, of course.
I think it's just the idea that they can articulate sounds despite not having, like, lips,
That's part of this show, though.
Animals don't need lips to make a sound.
They got to make everything aliens. And look, Ancient Aliens, I got to admit, they got me all jazzed up to see what they could find with these mummified Kappa remains. They talked about the remains.
Up.
Oh, I was. So I had to go buy the full episode. I got one to get to the bottom of this. I just found a clip of it. I was like, oh, I got to see the rest. And you know what? They never went back to the mummified remains. They just teased these webbed mummy hands, and they never mentioned it again. But it wasn't a total loss because I got this great David Wilcock clip. This is from later in the episode. And they're talking about how, I don't know, ancient aliens might have underwater portals and that there are ancient sightings of spaceships where the occupants just jump out of the ship and into the water, honey. And then he says this.
The legend said they described the star Sirius as being their point of origin and had very accurate information about a dwarf star called Sirius B that wasn't even known at the time. The Dogon said that when the Nomo landed and came out of this craft that they arrived in, they almost immediately got into the water. Because they were essentially fish-like humanoids, it seems that they needed to be in the water. We are definitely dealing with some sort of intelligent aquatic humanoid species that came here as an extraterrestrial visitor from outer space.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think you summed it up.
We're definitely dealing with that. That's exactly what it is, David.
That's why so many people hate ancient aliens. It's quotes like this. It's so long, but I had to clip it.
We are definitely dealing with some sort of intelligent aquatic humanoid species that came here as an extraterrestrial visitor from outer space.
Oh,
yeah, definitely.
Definitely. I would say so. I mean,
of course, because...
The Dogon said that when the Nomo landed and came out of this craft,
I don't know,
they arrived
the Dogon and the Nomo. It's like you get so lost in this with ancient aliens.
Well, the Dogon said that when the Nomo landed, they went straight to the water. I love the idea of just like aliens. I always imagine Greys as aliens for some reason, but I like to think that some of them getting out of their ship and they're just like by the water and they're just like, fuck it, let's just go for a swim. Like, they just go straight. Rather than explore the rest of the land, they just head straight for the water to go for a dip.
Yeah, like, they've talked about how the Ninjin might have abandoned their technology, and now we're talking about the Kappa, the weird Ninja Turtle bullheads being possibly aliens who just want to be
definitely,
here in the water.
Not possibly, definitely.
But they never got back. Look, those mummified remains I thought were fascinating. They never got back to them. So I did some further research into those remains, and look, if you're in Japan, either you... And you can go see these remains for yourself in the Tokyo neighborhood of Kappabashi that has adopted the Kappa as their mascot, this neighborhood. And I also learned that Kappa actually translates to raincoat. And in this town, it comes from the name of a local merchant, Kappaya Raincoat Seller Kikachi. So Kappaya Kikachi was the raincoat seller who funded the construction of a canal to prevent flooding and has said that these Kappas, aliens, cryptid, whatever they are, from the nearby Sumida River, they helped create the canal. And then when this guy, Mr. Kikachi, died in 1814, he was buried at the Sojinji Temple, which has since become known as the Kappa Dera or the Kappa Temple. And if you visit it now, look, be sure and bring a cucumber, as this is a very popular offering at the temple. If you go in the temple, there'll be cucumbers everywhere because, of course, it's their favorite food. They're piled up in this place. And you can see some, I don't know, they have cool scrolls with some drawings of Kappas that are kind of neat. And they have those mummified remains. They are still there. But I found nothing as far as analysis goes. So, I don't know, maybe go check them for yourself. I don't know what to tell you. You cannot find any information on these things ever being studied, but they're possibly part of an alien/Japanese cryptid.
Okay. Okay. Interesting.
And look, if you can't make it to Japan, Rob, there is a Hammer horror movie called Death Kappa, which might be more up our speed. We might have to watch
that sounds
one
fun.
Night.
Yeah, that sounds pretty good.
Sounds like
it's a Japanese horror movie?
Or some shit.
Yes, it's made by the Hammer Studios in the last decade or so, but it's called Death Kappa, which is some scary turtle monsters attacking.
Sick. That's dope. That's dope. I like it.
We should check it out.
I'm interested. What was the... Who was the turtle that fought Godzilla that was like a...
Gamera.
That was, huh?
Gamera?
Yes.
Gamera.
I'm pretty sure that's
kind of like that too. Kind of reminds me of that thing. Yeah, this is interesting. So many different, what a range.
I didn't know Gamera was also called Toto. Toto. I looked it up. Yeah. Gamera. Gamera.
Oh, yeah.
It was hard to even narrow it down. I know we covered a lot tonight. It was so hard to narrow it down. A lot of interesting cryptids. And we'll have to do other things as far as Japanese strangeness goes. But that's all. That's all I have for the Kappa. We're ready to close this out. I'm going to ask you, Dre, you have any final thoughts on Kappa or any of the other cryptids from tonight?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Honestly.
Rob, how about you?
I'm done.
Nah, we've covered it. We're good.
We're good. So look, be sure and answer this week's poll. What's the weirdest thing from Japan? Is it the Kappa or the Little Uncle or the Ninjin? Maybe there's a lantern. I don't know. We're going to have lots of things up there. Could be wet women could also be on there. Just go to unbelieverspodcast.com to vote, and let's say sayonara to this. Little old man got his own theme song.
Not where I thought that song was going.
Little old man sitting on a step. Yeah. He would do that.
Great classic, man. This was a lot of fun. I love these Japanese cryptids and spirits. We need to definitely will delve into this again in the future. These are definitely something new and exciting.
They're funny.
Yeah.
They're really funny. I was not expecting it to go the way that it went. It devolved into the wet. Women,
wet
and
women
old
with
men,
slit mouths and
turtle bullheads.
Yeah, I remember
lanterns.
The Dogon said that when the Nomo landed.
All right, David Wilcock. Enough with the Dogon and the Nomo.
Yeah, we don't know. We don't need Nomo with that, David Wilcock. Yeah.
Good on that.
Yeah. I'm kind of glad we stayed away from him. There's a lot of drama going on in the paranormal, but thankfully the secret space drama has definitely cooled down. And we don't have to worry about the Corey Goods and the David Wilcox as much anymore. They've kind of definitely tamed down.
Yeah. You know, it was good to listen to some clips from Ancient Aliens, though. I haven't watched that show in a while. I'm sure they're probably on, like,
for a good reason.
Season 39 by now or something like that. I know there's a lot.
It'll never end. Everything was an alien at some point. Of course, they even dragged a few Japanese cryptids into their world of all that. But, Let's do something we haven't done. I don't think we've done this at all this year, and people need to get on it. Let's hear some Unbelievers voice mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time.
Yeah, we got some voice mailbags. And, of course, yay, give us a call, 469-420-0114. That's probably the only phone number I still have memorized right now. But, Rob, what do you have for us?
We have one here. I know we missed a couple from, last month. There was a couple. We can actually, we'll go back now. Let's listen to these back from December real quick.
Oh, wow. Here we go.
I know we have a couple that we just never got to. So let's just listen to these. Let's see what these are all about.
What's up, dudes and Dreas? Chris, I know you're hanging out on the live stream too. Hey, Unbelievers. It's me, your friendly Whoopin' Hooper. If you're hearing this, unfortunately, I could not make it to the live stream, which is a bummer because I love going to those things. But it's my mom's birthday. Can't miss that. Speaking of, happy belated birthday to you, Dre. You're just fantastic, so I hope you had a good day. Rob, handsome as ever. Hope you get through that bottle of Fireball by the end of the year, buddy. Hopefully 2023 has some better alcohol for you. That'd be great. Russ, clever, powerful. Thanks for all you do. Chris, you're there too. You're cool as shit. I definitely consider you one of the crew, part of the crew, a four-pack. You guys are a four-pack, and you do a great job. I just want to say thanks for all that you guys do. I mean, I know it's not just me. I think that coming to the show, being able to listen to you guys make fun of Chandlers, Creeper Keepers, and Chip Coffee lightens the load quite a bit. So I really appreciate that. Please keep it up. Keep it going. This year had some of the funniest episodes yet, even though sometimes the schedule was a little sporadic and at times, and that's fine.
All right, we got better.
Yeah, that had some instant classic
rough
moments.
Year.
And sure. Yeah, there was a lot of animal mutilation. But
there
was also parakeets and caterpillars coming out of Kesha's ass. And to me, that kind of counterbalances it all. So, there you go. Yeah, I just want to say have a happy holidays. We'll see you guys in the new year. Rob, I got to go check on my cows. If you could play that clip, I'd appreciate that, bud. And we'll see you guys next year. Bye.
Yeah, talk about not playing one for a while. But I'm glad we did because I haven't heard that. Hey, I really appreciate it. That was a lot of nice words there. I really appreciate that. I like you said, even
we went out to check the cows. We had some cows that were about to calf.
Yeah, he called us out for this. We can bring it up now. Yeah, we had a bit of a sporadic schedule last year, but we are back on it this year, baby. We are coming in fucking both barrels this year. Right back
we're
on schedule.
We're coming in both barrels?
Coming in both barrels.
Disgusting.
We're coming in bowls on turtles' heads. We're doing it all. And I like that he gave a shout out to Chris. Talk about the fourth member. That was pretty cool. Chris did a lot. We did a lot of live streams last year, and she was a part of a lot of them. And yeah, definitely love hearing that shout out there. So thanks for that. That was a great call.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for the happy birthday, too. That makes me feel happy even yeah, Andreas, 3 months
later.
Like
it's March.
Does.
Thanks for reminding me of our birthday. It was in December.
I know. I was confused for a second. Then I was like, oh, right. This is an old one. But yeah
bow,
thank you.
Otherwise, you die.
All right.
What?
And we've got one more older one here that we're going to listen to real quick. Another blast from the past voicemail. Let's listen to it. Here we go.
Yo, Unbelievers, it's Pants Filler. Sorry I can't be watching you on Twitch tonight. Basically, my technology and bullshit fucking sucks. Sorry for the language, children. But anyways, you guys keep rocking on. And by the way, golden rice in Philippines, they're having riots over that. It's totally being suppressed in the media here. So... deuces and wait, hold on. I'm gonna throw up. It's in my pants.
No, come on. Get this guy out. Get off my phone.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, another great throwback. I guess these were from the end of last year. Yeah, we haven't checked the voicemail in a while. And hey, Unbeliever, step up. Give us some new voicemails. We want to hear some. I know we have a more recent one. Let's
we
hear
do
that.
Have a newer one. I know you're asking for a new one, so we'll play a new one that we just got.
Yeah,
this
here
is from
we go.
The other day. We got this last week. So here we go. Listen to this one.
Salutations, Unbelievers. This is your arch nemesis, Joshua P. Warren.
Oh, shit.
Now, recently I've become aware of some accusations made by you and yours regarding the status of my integrity and honesty as a person. I was calling to let you know that I reject these claims, but in a show of honesty, I'd like to regale you with a story. This morning, I woke up and had sex with my wife, and my performance was unremarkable.
Well, thank you for checking in,
fabulous.
Joshua P. Warren. He's acknowledging as being our nemesis. I appreciate that.
I appreciate the details of his unlovely love life.
His unsatisfying.
How did he get our number?
Unremarkable.
How does he know? What's going on?
Oh, he has his ways. Don't you know he's such a great guy? He's so smart. Of course he could find our number.
I was honestly, I was kind of, for the first half of that message, I was like,
you,
holy
you got
shit.
A little scared?
I was like, holy shit. This is
oh,
really
I was
it.
Like,
on that note, I'm out of here.
No, what's funny is that, like, usually I would hate that, right? That would be like, oh no, I'm so embarrassed. This is fucking embarrassing. But even if that were true, if it really was him, I would have been like, yeah, finally. finally he gets to hear what people really think of it. Because he is a piece of shit, you know?
That is so good. What a great impression. Whoever you are out there.
Fantastic.
Thank you, Josh. Remarkable. For chiming in. Yeah, I want more people to chime in. I want Jeremy Leonard to come chime in on the voicemail. I want, I don't know, the Kappa. Somebody, come call our voicemail. Give us some fun stuff to play.
I don't know if it's a good Kappa impression.
I don't know. Do Larry King. Do's like,
yeah, do Larry
somebody
King.
Good.
Do somebody
do this
know.
Guy.
George Norrie. Can you do, whoever can do a good George Norrie?
I would love a George Norrie, but I would also really like a Bledsoe with a...
I'm a big guy. If you want me, you got me.
So give me some Chris Bledsoe's coming in there. I'd love that. Because, come on, they could say stuff. Oh, be the other guy and be like...
I got some paranoia to open my pocket knife.
But yeah, thank you everyone for chiming on the voicemail. Let's hear more. And let's move on now to everyone's third favorite segment. What's that, Drea?
Poll results.
This week's poll, who do you want to visit you this Easter? And the choices were the Easter Bunny, the glass alien, Jesus, or the Mother Goddess. I'll ask you, I don't know, Rob Oakey, what do you think the unbelievers said?
I'm a sucker for candy, so Easter Bunny.
Going Easter Bunny, all
awesome
right.
Some of them eggs, give me them eggs.
How about you, Drea?
I want to see what the glass alien would bring me, so I would have voted that.
Oh, well, sorry to both of you with, wow, a whopping 16% of the vote. A lot of people voted for the Mother Goddess. The Mother Goddess. Easter Bunny and Glass Alien tied for second.
Yeah. That's actually, that makes sense. I know
mommy?
Our audience.
Okay.
Yeah, we know what they're about.
No they one voted for Jesus. I just want to note that.
No,
so.
Because you know, Jesus already does come back every Easter.
Yeah, that's true.
So that's a given.
Well, he does.
You don't need to vote for it. But it's going to happen anyway.
It's just going
to
happen.
It's true.
Even if you don't want it to. No. Oh, God damn it. Jesus is here again. Fuck.
Everyone wants that Mother Goddess. But, of course, there are others. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Easter? That's a Sunday. If anyone comes to my house on my day off, I will personally right there and kick their ass. Signed, it's Corrupted Mask.
I like that. That was a good one.
Thank you, Corrupted Mask. Oh, man, I haven't heard that one in a long time. That
I will personally come to your house and kick your ass.
Thank you, Art. Thank you, Corrupted Mask. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? My old dad, so I can tell him what I think of him. Signed. Come on.
Scared of my dad.
Scared of my dad guy. Yeah. Chiming in. Thanks, scared of my dad guy. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Truth be told, I'd want some sort of manimal to come visit me, but I'd be too chicken. XOXO. Signed, Dudu Bin Laden. Thank you, Dudu Bin Laden.
Always good.
I guess he wants a half man something. He wants half human.
I think this is
half human.
This is definitely a Jesse Ventura manimal chicken reference.
Oh, he wants a chicken. He wants the chicken reference. Okay.
Yeah.
Guess that makes him part human, part chicken.
Thank you, Dudu Bin Laden. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Still sticking with sloth. Rocky Road Easter eggs. Hey, you guys. Signed, Hose B. Wow, bringing up sloth again. And we talked about sloths tonight. We talked about aquatic sloths and land sloths.
True, I guess you're right.
Who
we
became
did.
The ninjin. Oh, very topical. We don't have sloth on the soundboard, though. But thank you, Hose B. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Your heart is connected to your butt. Not directly, but for sure. Drea Mora, host sure. quotes. There we go.
Yes.
Yeah, that sounds like something she would say.
It totally does. I'm sure I've said it.
And you talked about heart connected to your butt, and we talked about your anus being
pulling
connected
your heart
to your soul
out through your butt.
Tonight. Remember
yeah,
the
you rip
the,
your whole soul and heart out through your butt. Yeah,
man, Drea, both of these
on it.
Host B, the Drea host quotes. You guys are tied for the lead. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? My degenerate father, but you didn't sign off. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? The Mother Goddess and Crescent at the same time. And the Mantis Cuck had better film whatever happens next. Signed, Unbeliever Maxwell. All right. Very descriptive.
I like it.
Yeah, I like that. All right, come on.
This is one of the large women. And I had sex with this woman.
All right. That was a great one. Thank you, Unbeliever Maxwell.
That one enough.
Who do you want to visit you this Easter? The Matthew McConaughey voiceover guy. Signed, Bradley. Oh, the Matthew McConaughey voiceover guy. I know.
That's a reference that I definitely
remember. That's reference from last week. Hold on. I think, oh, God, do I have something for him?
I'm saying reserve judgment. Reserve judgment.
That's not it. Sorry about that.
I wish.
I don't think that's him.
I'll show it to you.
Okay, Bradley, I'll show it to you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that sounded like it.
Who do you want to visit you this Easter? A horse. Signed, Mothman Father. Oh, I don't know about that.
He wants a horse?
I don't know.
I'll give you a horse.
I don't know, Mothman Father. As Eric Berry would say,
I don't fool with no horses, boy.
Thank you, Mothman Father. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Honestly, I've got nothing. Steak, yum, 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 going down the gum. Signed, Whooping Hooper. Thank you.
I'm so glad
Whooping
somebody
called. Wow, Whooping Hooper making all the poll and on the voicemail tonight. All right. I don't like talking about...
That was the Dungarvan Hooper. That was Hooping.
Thank you, Whooping Hooper. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? What do you think tap water is? It's a gay bomb, baby. Signed, Alex Jones at Globalism Eraser. At Globalism Eraser.
I think that's just actually Alex Jones commenting.
It might be.
Oh, okay. Wait, Alex Jones has got to get out there whoever he can. You know, he's been like, he's been to platforms
everywhere.
He's
trying. Yeah. He's trying.
Come
on,
Alex
hard.
Jones. Come on.
This hamburger has no cheese, no ketchup, no mustard, no lettuce, no onions, no tomatoes.
Thank you, Alex Jones at Globalism Eraser. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? Some spicy ghost. Oh, you didn't sign off either. And the final one for this evening. Who do you want to visit you this Easter? The gray that was observing us from the roof. Signed, Mike Dak. That'd be a great one to visit you. Come on.
A gray on the roof observing us.
All right.
That one scares me.
As always... And especially this year, there's so many great ones this year. Oh man, I don't know. I really liked Hose B sticking with Sloth, Rocky Road Easter eggs. Hey, you guys. And Andrea Mora, Hose Quest was great with your heart is connected to your butt, not directly, but for sure. Andrea, which ones did you like?
I really liked, Dudu Bin Laden always coming through. Because again, I like to favor the ones that actually answer the question and everything. Do it in a clever way. Because I also really did like the host quotes one, but that's just for my own personal reasons.
Sure, yeah. Dudu Bin Laden came in with, truth be told, I'd want some sort of manimal to come visit me, but I'd be too chicken, XOXO. That is a really good one. I like that one. What about you, Rob? Anything stand out to you?
I need a little refresher. Like, give me a couple more. What were, like, some of the other good ones?
Of course, Corrupted Mask Easter. That's a Sunday. If anyone comes to my house on a day off, I will personally
right there and
kick their ass.
I believe her Maxwell too. Was
That was very well put. I think it was actually the perfect use of
that
a
was
soundboard
good, yeah.
in multiple ways. So yeah, I would give it to Corrupted Mask. That's my vote.
All right, you like Corrupted Mask? I mean, I thought that I like Alex Jones is chiming in. And man, Dudu Bin Laden and Hose B, you guys, I know he's sticking with Sloth. Stick with Sloth, he's going to get there, but congratulations. Corrupted Mask with Easter, that's a Sunday. If anyone comes to my house on my day off, I will personally, whatever, right there and kick their ass. He doesn't say it right. Play the clip because he says, I will personally dot UHSAA right there and kick their ass. I know the spirit of it, Corrupted Mask. You're going to win on a technicality, but play the clip.
I will personally come to your house and kick your ass.
Thank you. Congratulations, Corrupted Mass. Somehow you just won this week's poll results. All right, well, we've come to the end of the program, but before we go, Drea Moore, do you have anything you want to say or plug?
No, not too much. I guess the usual Spirits and Spirits pod and Snacking with Jack.
Yeah, check those
Got
out.
Got a new episode of that. That was a fun one.
Absolutely. And how about you, Rob?
I just want to say I love these longer episodes where we're all like delirious towards the end of poll results. We're just like, what is even going on? This was fun. Check out my Instagram at Rob Oakey. Check out the show's Instagram, of course. Go like and subscribe to all the things. Go to our YouTube. Follow the Patreon. There's going to be some new stuff coming. We're always coming up with new ideas and, you know, there's always something new on the Patreon. So check it out.
Yeah, for sure. There's definitely some new things coming there. And yes, you're all right. The poll result always does hit us when we're already a little punch drunk from doing a long episode.
Delirious. It's
great. We get rope-a-dope by these great comments. So thank you, everyone. Go to unbelieverspodcast.com. Yeah, remember, this week's poll, what's the weirdest thing in Japan? That should be some fun poll results. So go do that. The Unbelievers Podcast hosts today were Drea Mora and me, Russ Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Oakey. You can join our Patreon by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. You can follow us on Twitter at unbelieverspod and Instagram at unbelievers. Podcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. And check out our merch store at TeePublic. There's a link in the description. Our official music advisor is Pandora 3373. Our official composer and theme song creator who created our theme. That guy is Unbeliever Aaron, a.k.a. Aaron Shilb. Follow him on Instagram at TheAaronShilb. Our official graphic designer and card maker who designed our logo is Raymond Rowell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and Project Raven Creative on Instagram. Our official Guardian of the Bench is at Kraken Stacker. Our official Alien Bopper is Nunchuck Bop. And from the Patreon, our official Big Island Paranormal Friendly Weatherman is Green Finhawk. Our official Procrastinator is Jeffrey Hartneriff. Our official Baby Yoda Publicist is Pam Z. Our official Unbeliever Listening Between the Stations for a Message from Art Bell is Scott E. Our official Unbeliever Raising Puck Wudgies is Joe Filler. Our official Madman is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Unbeliever's Time Traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official Snack is Jackass. Our official Ghost Hunter is Amelia Childs. And Ghost Hunting in New England, our official Senior European Correspondent is Kay Mill of the I Don't Know Podcast. Our official Paranormal Art Curator is Isis Haynes. Our official Rod is Rod Begliominio Bellagosi. Our official Unbeliever in Need of Titles are Mike Henry, Todd X, Lid Vicious, Sandra Devil Foles, Ramiro Trash Baby, Adam Dvorak, Wombat Preservationist. And this week's Unbeliever Focus is Brandon Cardona, who tells me he is so excited for spring. This is the first day of spring we are recording on. And of course, spring break coming soon because,
woo!
Yeah,
woo!
On the beach, when this guy hits the water, the ladies all say,
we are definitely dealing with some sort of intelligent aquatic humanoid species that came here as an extraterrestrial visitor from outer space.
All right, good night.
Discontinue! Discontinue!